please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome to Reporters Diary at 6. I'm Arif Sherwani. Let's take a look at what's making news this evening. So global tailwinds have ensured a steady Monday on Dalal Street. Binani Cement seeks permission from the Supreme Court for an out-of-court settlement of its insolvency proceedings, while Xiaomi India bets on Make in India and will set up 3 new manufacturing plants. But our top story this evening is that the RBI may make modifications to the NPA resolution circular soon. So the central bank had issued its previous circular on the 12th of February to accommodate representations made by banks for certain tweaks to that circular. This comes a day before the Parliamentary Standing Committee is scheduled to take up that tweaks required in that 12th February circular. In fact, for more details, let's go across to Ritu Singh. Ritu, so what are the changes that banks are seeking?
Well, you know, any relaxations whatsoever in the Feb 12 circular on NPA resolution norms will come as a big relief to banks that have been crying horse about some of the stringent conditions attached with the Feb 12 circular from the word go. We understand that representations have been made to the Reserve Bank of India by both the government through its nodal agency, the Indian Banks Association, as well as from representatives of the Department of Financial Services to make certain modifications in the circular and relax certain conditions. As you said, the Parliamentary Committee meeting is scheduled tomorrow with the bankers on this very issue, and we are expecting that the Reserve Bank of India will act soon to make some of these modifications. Now, there are 10 things specifically that banks have requested RBI to tweak, and some of the key ones are, number one, remove the one-day default identification and instead give banks a 30-day cure period to make a move on identification or reporting of a default. Second, the number of votes required to pass a resolution should be brought down from an unrealistic 100% votes required to only 75%. Banks have also sought relaxations in refinancing of large standard infrastructure loans and said that they should not be considered restructuring and identified as standard even after refinancing is extended. Similar other such relaxations have been sought in the timeline also for the referring to the corporate insolvency process itself. So these are the key conditions. But of course, you know, in tomorrow's meeting, we have to wait and see what the banks have to say to the DFS, but some modifications are likely very soon.
Right, thanks for that, Ritu. But on to the day's market action. So markets followed strong cues from Asian markets to end with steady gains today. The Nifty and Sensex closed with gains of about 0.5%. Mid-caps also mirrored benchmarks with gains of 0.25%, while banks outperformed, rallying close to 1%. So essentially, a good day for the markets. Let's also take a quick check of the global markets as well. So Wall Street expected to bounce back when the U.S. markets go live in some time from now. Remember, Friday saw the Dow Jones sink over 550 points. European indices like the German DAX are also trading 0.5% in the green right now. The French CAC just marginally higher, but the FTSE seeing a slightly negative on the board there. So that's what the market picture looks like. But let's take you to the other top story that we're tracking this evening. So Binani Industries has knocked on the Supreme Court's door in order to get its stamp of approval on Ultratech's out-of-court settlement offer for debt-ridden Binani Cement. Now, remember, the move comes days after Binani Cement's lenders have decided to go back Ultratech's bid, provided it gets a go-ahead from the Supreme Court. Ashmit Kumar was tracking the proceedings. He joins us now with all the details. Ashmit, what are you picking up?
Well, let's keep in mind that the NCLAT, in the 3rd of April order that it had passed that provided for an out-of-court settlement, clearly provided that should there be such an out-of-court settlement, it would have to be vetted by a competent authority, in this case, which happens to be the Apex Court. So expectedly, Binani Industries moving the Apex Court, as you rightly said, with their out-of-court settlement offer. The offer we picked up from councils is in the neighborhood of 7,600 plus the interest till the commencement of insolvency proceedings. The two prayers that Binani Industries has made very clearly is, number one, for the Supreme Court to grant its nod for its approval as far as the out-of-court settlement is concerned, and the other being the termination of insolvency proceedings. So clearly this is the big trigger that all the stakeholders in this case will be watching for. The Apex Court on its part has agreed to hear the application, will be doing so on April 13th. That's this coming Friday. That's when, in fact, they will be hearing all the arguments as far as Binani Industry and its proposal for an out-of-court settlement is concerned. Just as a side note, also important to mention that the NCLT, which was supposed to hear this case today, has deferred the hearing until after the Apex Court hearing on April 13th. The NCLT will now pick up this case on April 16th. So clearly, all eyes, all stakeholders, clearly watching out for that big trigger on April 13th, this coming Friday, when the apex court takes up this case. Back to you.
Right, Ashmit, thanks so much for joining us with all the details from there. But shifting focus to the other story in focus, the CBI today called Rajiv Kochar for questioning in the ICICI Bank Videocon case for the fifth consecutive day. So Rajiv was questioned on Sunday as well, along with two directors of New Power Renewables. The CBI investigation has revealed that ICICI Bank mandated Avista, his company, to restructure deals worth over $1.5 billion for seven companies over a period of 6 years. Utkarsh Chaturvedi has been tracking all the developments and he joins us from the CBI headquarters. Utkarsh, what's the latest from there?
So around 7 to 8 hours of questioning again for the fifth day for Rajiv Kochar. It's not only him, in fact, the director of NU Power, Mahesh Punglia, who was also, you know, was very very closely associated with Videocon, was also questioned for the third day by CBI. Now, the case is simple that, you know, Avista Advisory, which is the firm of Rajiv Kochar, went ahead and advised restructuring of deals to a host of companies, which also happened to be clients of ICICI Bank. Now, what CBI claims is that in their preliminary investigation, they have found that it is ICICI Bank who used to mandate Avista Advisory to go through all of these restructuring deals. Now, this is something which CBI is probing at this point of time, whether there was any quid pro quo involved in that. On the other hand, the question of Mahesh Chandra Punglia is about the 64 crore rupees gift, which we are speaking about from day one, on the basis of which the PE has been registered. Now, the way ahead will be, when is it that CBI really feels comfortable in the investigation to file an FIR? Because remember, till the time they have not filed an FIR, they cannot really go ahead and do any kind of searches or raids in this. And also very important, when is it that Chanda Kochar or Deepak Kochar will be likely to be present, CBI will ask them to be present for questioning here.
Right, Utkarsh, thanks so much for bringing us the latest from that case. But investigation into the alleged nexus between ICICI Bank CEO Chanda Kochar and Videocon Group's Venugopal Dhoot gathers steam. During this time, credit ratings agency Fitch Ratings has issued a warning as well. In its statement, Fitch has said that the allegations of a potential conflict of interest raises questions over the bank's governance and creates reputational risks. The ratings agency adds that the ongoing investigation could also undermine investor confidence in the bank. It has warned that there is potential risk of financial penalties as well as legal action if the investigation comes up with findings against the bank. Fitch also further going on to say that it will closely monitor developments and would take appropriate ratings action if the risk to the bank's reputation as well as financial profile were to rise considerably. But that's not all. A BJP lawmaker, Udit Raj, has alleged that ICICI Lombard has embezzled around 1,000 crore rupees that had been allocated to the Rajiv Gandhi Shilpa Swastha Bima Yojana, a health insurance scheme for artisans. My colleague Sapna Das spoke to him earlier. Here's a slice of that conversation.
Mr. Raj, thank you so much for giving time to CNBC TV 18. The Chanda Kochar ICICI Bank matter is very, very important at the moment. You have said very clearly that white collar criminals should be brought to book. Isn't it a very serious charge that you are brought against a bank CEO?
These are the facts. It's not a charge. What happened that government funds these agencies to empower poor farmers, artisans, and Ministry of Textile transferred hundreds of crores of funds to ICICI
Lombard.
ICICI Lombard.
1,000 crores.
So hundreds of crores to empower artisans. In Rajasthan alone, they enrolled 30,000 artisans. Out of 30,000, about 12,000 were found bogus. In another scheme, that is weather-based crop insurance, Ganga Nagar, out of 3,200. 2,200 from non-existence. So if you total the embezzlement amount of whole country, it comes to thousands of crores and of many years. I wrote letter in 2013, nothing happened. And CBI registered the case in Jaipur. Then it was wound up. I raised the issue in the parliament. I got the reply from the parliament.
What was the reply from Mr. Santosh?
Parliament reply I am giving to you. They said that action will be initiated. That matter was hushed up also.
Right, but let's revisit our top story once again, where we told you the RBI may make modifications to the NPA resolution circular soon. The central bank had issued its previous circular on the 12th of February to accommodate representations made by banks for certain tweaks to that circular. We're joined now by VG Kannan of the Indian Banks Association, and Ritu Singh is here to take us through that conversation. Over to you, Ritu.
Thank you, Arif. Well, Mr. VG Kannan, the chief of Indian Banks Association, the nodal agency representing all of the banks in these negotiations or talks with the RBI as well as the government. Mr. Kannan, thank you very much for joining us on the show on CNBC TV 18. Let me first start by asking you, you know, we heard from the DFS secretary, you know, we heard from Mr. Rajiv Kumar saying that they had made representations on behalf of the power ministry and other steel ministries to the RBI. We just want to understand from you, from the bankers, what are some of the key proposals or some of the key changes that you have sought in the Feb 12 circular?
I think the February 12 circular had a few areas where we felt a bit uncomfortable. Mm. For example, they had stipulated it has to be 100% approved by all the lenders. So which we said it's a practical difficulty, mainly because it's difficult to get everyone on board or on it. So yeah. We said the way it has happened in the case of NCLT cases, IBC, hmm. has 75% approval of there. We said on the same lines, this could be enabled. So that's one of the asks we have made.
Hmm.
And second thing is we felt that certain existing schemes, which are already invoked by the various bankers,
yeah.
and in various stages of implementation,
yeah.
should not be overnight. Suddenly, the carpet is taken out,
mm.
and therefore we felt that it is essential that this particular thing may be continued for the period of 18 months or whatever it is, or 31st of August, whichever is earlier. So this is two of the things.
Okay, sir.
And beyond, yeah.
Mr. Kannan, you know, from what we understand, both you and government have already made representations, but are you reasonably confident that the regulator will listen to these pleas, and how soon can we expect these modifications? Because you're a veteran banker, I mean, you understand some of the repercussions of that circular. Obviously, some tweaks are needed. So how confident are you that the regulator will respond soon enough?
Yeah, I think this is not a question which I can respond. You will understand that it's very difficult to actually read the mind of the regulator always. But yes, we are hopeful, mm. and we feel that these are all not unreasonable demands.
Mm.
We have not asked them to scrap the circular.
Mm.
What we said is give some temporary relief, and I'm sure RBI will consider them favorably. This is our fond hope. And we are confident that there will be something. How confident? I can't put a percentage.
Hmm.
23% or 63%, I can't do that.
Mr. Kannan, just one last question also before we let you go. You know, given that you've studied this circular very well, could you give our viewers a rough estimate? I mean, if these norms were to be applied in their current, you know, format that they are, in this quarter itself, how much of a hit would banks have to take on account of declaring NPAs as per this circular?
I don't think it's proper for me to give any, hazard any information on this or give any information, though. We have made some rough estimates, but that could be very, very rough, and then it may not be proper for me to give any.
But sir, if you could give us a ballpark figure, what would be the impact of this circular in this quarter?
I won't like to give that.
All right, sir. Thank you very much then for joining us on CNBC TV 18. Arif, it's back to you in the studio there.
Xiaomi has doubled its bet on India. The Chinese smartphone maker today announcing its plans to set up 3 more manufacturing plants, a decision where it would take its tally of factories in India to 6 now. My colleague Ranjoy Banerjee caught up exclusively with Manu Jain, the global vice president of Xiaomi, to know more about their Make in India plans.
Xiaomi has had a great success in India. We just started about 3.5 years ago. And in a short period of 3 years, we became the number one smartphone brand. I think one of the key things that really helped us was our whole approach towards making in India. We said 3 years ago when we started off, we said we want to make phones locally here. We want to design phones for India and make them locally here in the country. So we had 2 big manufacturing plants, both of them in AP, Andhra Pradesh. And we are taking the next big leap today. The first thing that we are announcing is we're setting up 3 more plants. Across
3 more additional smartphone manufacturing plants.
Yes, across two campuses. The one big campus is in Andhra Pradesh, Sri City, and there's a new campus which is being built in Tamil Nadu, in Sri Perumbudur near Chennai. Right. So across both these plants, we'll have across both these campuses, we'll have five manufacturing plants, all of them owned and operated by a partner, Foxconn. And in addition to this, we also have a manufacturing unit in Noida in partnership with HiPat, where we used to make power banks. And even in this particular unit, we will start making phones. So we'll now manufacture phones across six different plants, five with Foxconn and one with HiPat.
And you can catch that entire interview at 6:30 p.m. only on CNBC TV 18. And moving on from there, the insurance regulator has proposed reducing the premium on vehicles which are less than 1,000 cc. So this has irked the third-party motor insurers as this bill reduced their premium pool by a good margin. Speaking to CNBC TV 18, HDFC Ergo's Mukesh Kumar said that this reduction in premium will not drive volume growth, but rather will have a negative impact on their collections. Here's an excerpt from that conversation.
One very important amendment, rather in the proposal stage at the moment, is that the regulator has asked a reduction in the motor third-party insurance across categories. How should one see this? If I were to ask you as HDFC Ergo, would this lead to a hit as far as your premium collection is concerned because they will be reduced, or should it be seen as something which will drive volumes in the motor segment?
It clearly cannot drive the volumes because the reduction in premium is primarily on the vehicle which are less than 1,000 cc.
Right.
And that's not a very huge segment.
Okay.
It will have an impact, but not very significant impact. But still, we hope that the impact should be negative.
Okay.
For sure.
And what part of your total portfolio comes from motor in terms of your total premium? And with this particular proposal actually turning into regulation where we will see reduced motor third-party insurance, what kind of percentage impact could we see in terms of reduction of the premium?
In terms of reduction of premium, we are expecting a total motor portfolio reduction about maybe 1%,
right.
1.5%.
Right.
In terms of total portfolio for us in motor is about 27%+.
Right.
Now, Chinese President Xi Jinping will deliver a speech tomorrow at the Bao Forum in Asia. Reports suggest that Jinping may announce measures to de-escalate trade tensions between China and the United States. Now, one measure amongst them could be allowing greater foreign direct investment in the country. CNBC's Martin Soong has that report. And continuing with global news, a suspected chemical attack in Syria's Duma has killed 12 people while injuring several others. President Donald Trump has lashed out at Russian President Vladimir Putin as well as Iran, blaming them for those attacks. Meanwhile, the Russians claim that two Israeli jets have bombed the Syrian airbase. Here's a special report by Tammy Leitner of NBC News. However, we would like to warn our viewers that this NBC news report has graphic content which could be disturbing. Tragic visuals there from Syria. But with that, it's a wrap on this edition of Reporter's Diary. Many thanks for watching.